Good afternoon, everybody. So, I will discuss some genetic evidence coming from one of the experiments that Katarina mentioned, from African buffaloes experimentally infected with a mixture of SAT1, 2, and 3 viruses. Our aim was to study with the weedy host evolution and genetic variability post-inoculation. Since SAT1 is the only serotype that was persistent after 1 year post-inoculation, we'll focus only on SAT1. What was sequenced was essentially the inoculum, some laser microdissections from different tissues, tonsils, dorsal soft palate, and so on, from 3 different buffaloes at 35 and 400 days post-inoculation, plus some sequencing of probang and tonsil swabs taken from the same and different animals. I got out 2 sets of results. The first one is about the genetic structure in terms of quasi-species and selection. So this is a graphical illustration of what we find. The yellow one are genomes, and the mutations are illustrated by color dots on the genomes. So what we expect in a usual FMDV infection is a quasi-species or a swarm of low-frequency variants that have emerged due to the high mutation rate of FMDV. This is not at all what we found in the inoculum. In the inoculum, we found a structure with 2 different quasi-species with a divergence of about 3%, so very similar ones, plus a large fraction of recombinants between these 2 quasi-species. The initial frequencies were about the same, 55 and 45%. One of these recombinants is particularly important. It was about 2% frequency in the inoculum, and it is it has 2 non-synonymous mutations with respect that were combining from one quasi-species to the other. Now, what is striking is what happened after inoculation at 35 and 400 days in buffaloes. So after this complex inoculum, SAT1 inoculum, was inoculated, there was a striking change in the frequencies of the 2 quasi-species as observed in the buffaloes both at 35 and 400 days post-inoculation. So with Sanger sequences from palatine and pharyngeal tonsils and dorsal soft palate. And if you look at how these frequencies were changed across different animals and tissues, so after inoculation, you see in the column different colors of the 3 quasi-species and recombinants. And you see that one of the quasi-species disappeared in every single animal and tissue, and the other 2 changed their frequency significantly in a consistent way across all animals and tissues. This is a strong signal that there has been deterministic selection pressure on these quasi-species during the acute infection phase. This would be a nice result, if not that the story is much more complicated. In particular, tonsil swabs have been surprising enough. So the frequencies illustrated here are for laser microdissections taken from palatine pharyngeal tonsils and dorsal soft palate. Of course, the swabs are taken from the oropharyngeal tract, and all the swabs were, instead of being a mixture in terms of composition of the 2 quasi-species, were represented by a single recombinant with little genetic variability, as you can see in the illustration. And in the sequences, the green and the brown illustrate the composition of the recombinants in terms of the 2 original quasi-species. Moreover, as you can see from the red and the black triangles, there were a lot of synonymous and non-synonymous, but mostly synonymous substitution rates in these swabs that were not observed within the tissues. And the substitution rate is about as fast as the one that you would observe in a phylogenetic setting, and little evidence of immune escape across the whole experiment. So our hypothesis is beyond strong selection during the acute infection phase, that there is also some smaller reservoir of cells that is actually where the virus is actually replicating during the persistent phase, and this is what gives rise to this virus that is usually found in the probangs. So the weedy host dynamics is quite complex and tissue dependent, and it's not straightforward to say what's going on and what is the virus that could effectively be propagating as a reservoir. Another aspect that was quite striking of the whole picture was the amount of Weddin-Ostler combination that we found. So let me show you the sequences. So these are the sequences, about 600 sequences from three animals. They are colored in terms of their alleles. So the gray and blue alleles correspond to the original quasi-species, and the red ones are essentially new mutations. And you can see that in each species, on the top, there is essentially one quasi-species. On the bottom, there is another quasi-species. And in the middle, there is a large range of recombinants, so sequences that show a mixture of gray and blue along the sequence. And this is something quite unexpected, because while recombination rates in FNDV are not so low, we were not expecting to find a massive amount of recombinant within OS sequences, and in more or less all the animals. By the way, an interesting thing of this plot is that you can also see that the genetic structure of the among different animals is pretty much the same. So essentially, the way the infection proceeds is quite predictable once the inoculum is the same for the three animals. This, again, is a sign of the strong selection that you have during the acute infection phase. So these are the recombinant sequences that we observe. We can track how much recombination changes in time. So if recombination goes on during the acute phase and during the persistent phase of the infection, we expect to find more and more recombinant over time, and this is precisely what we find. If you look at the black line, you see that from the inoculum to 35 days post-inoculation, we see a strong increase in the number of recombinants. And then we find another increase, even if lower, up to one year post-inoculation. The genetic diversity shows a similar pattern as expected if the virus is actually replicating all the way in. Now, we can estimate, interestingly enough, the absolute recombination rates during the infection under some assumptions. During the acute phase, the recombination rate that we estimate is as large as 0.2 per base per year. That is impressively large. And even during the persistent phase, the numbers are about 5 per mil per base per year. It is still a very or sensibly high recombination rate. Now, these numbers are interesting for two reasons. Well, by themselves, they give us an estimate of how much recombination is occurring within host. But we also know that recombination is closely related to viral replication. FNDV does not recombine except during viral replication, essentially. So under some simple assumptions, we can assume that the ratio of the recombination rates is actually the ratio of the replication rates of the virus. And this is an interesting result, because we can estimate that during the persistent phase, the virus is still replicating, but at a rate that is about 40 times lower than during the acute phase of the infection. Now, this result refers essentially to the tonsils and to the dorsal soft palate where we are actually sampling the virus. But still, we can put a rough number to the relative replication rate during the persistent phase. That is, as expected, much lower than during the acute one. What we can also obtain is, of course, a combination map for the combination rate along the capsid. Now, recombination rates along the capsid, you can look at the black line, and this is essentially a smoothing of what is the recombination rate across the capsid. It looks quite high and not so different in the capsid with respect to LPRO or 2A, 2B. Now, this is not expected. We know from phylogenetic estimates that there should be almost no recombination within the capsid compared to the regions outside the capsid. Is this compatible with the phylogenetic results? We did a more complete study trying to get lots of wild buffalo deep sequencing samples with SAT1, 2, 3, and so on. And we tried to compare the recombination events that we could find in these samples with the recombination rate at a phylogenetic scale. And the comparison is between the gray intervals here and the red line. And you can see that while there is some correspondence, basically a statistic that there is a mismatch between the recombination rate that occurs within host and the recombination rate that we observe between phylogenetically very diverse sequences. The causes could be selection and epistasis during transmission and so on. Okay. Now, it's quite important to realize that, of course, recombination is affected by the selection forces within host and during the infection and transmission events. So, of course, the mismatch between these two patterns could be due to the selection pressures during infection and transmission. Now, it's difficult to get a glimpse of what these pressures are. What we can do is go back to our initial experiment and focus on VP1, for which we have data for the three infected buffers that I showed you. And since these sequences were Sanger sequenced, and a lot of them from microdissections actually, so we can reconstruct not only the profiles, but the full recombination map between different pieces of VP1. And this is showing the lower triangle here. So where the yellow is more is clearer, that means that there is more recombination and less relation between the mutations. And you see quite clearly that there are two genetic blocks. And there is a mosaic structure, not only within the FNVB genome, that was well known, but there is a mosaic structure even within the VP1 protein, at least for what concerns evolution within host. Now, this is interesting and unexpected, also because the recombination within VP1 is very rare phylogenetically, so there was not much chance to study that in a larger context. But what is more interesting is that we can try to estimate from the way recombination behaves with distance, we can try to estimate if the recombination that we observe is compatible with the recombination rate that we measure, if you want, from this plot. So the comparison gives us a measure of epistasis between mutation. That is, when you recombine between the two quasi species, you disrupt a series of co-evolved mutations that were beneficial in terms of coevolution, and this causes potentially a change in the fitness of the recombinants. So recombinants tend to have lower fitness, and this reduces the apparent recombination rate. And this reduction is illustrated here on the top in blue. The more intense the blue, the stronger is the reduction. And you see that these two genetic blocks in VP1 are actually held together by the lower fitness of the recombinant, actually. We can zoom in on this. So this is a zoom in of the same results. So a measure of how strong is the selection against recombinants, if you want, for different pairs of recombinants in VP1. What we can try to do is, of course, this is a generic measure. We can try to pinpoint which pairs of mutations have the strongest effect in terms of selection against recombinants. This is what is done here in green. So the green ones are much less than the blue ones and corresponds to pair of mutations that are disrupted by recombination in a sensible way. And we can have a look at what these mutations are. So most of these mutations are synonymous. So if selection is acting on the RNA structure of the virus. But a few of these mutations that I illustrated here in this plot are actually non-synonymous. And we can test how many interactions do we see between these mutations. They are illustrated here in red. I hope you can see them. And these interactions are a significant amount compared to the overall interaction, suggesting that actually selection is not acting only at the RNA level, but is actually acting also on the protein level. So we have epistatic selection on the sequences at both levels. This is all within host selection, of course. There is different selection for infection and transmission that we don't have control on. There are lots of large-scale consequences for these results in terms of the generation of haplotype diversity. And in fact, we see from our results a trend towards generating more haplotype diversity through recombination. There could be some new mechanism for exchanging genetic variability between FNDV strains, essentially recombination-mediated exchanges of short fragments. So is this kind of exchanges of these short fragments here. So the sequence will be more or less the same, but with short fragments coming from other viruses. And then there could be several reasons for the phylogenetic suppression of recombination that had to do with the selection pressure on infection and transmission and on epidemiology. And we have some suggestions, but up to now there's no way to know what is essentially going on at the larger scale. So the summary is that deep sequencing of FNV data is full of surprises. There is a non-trivial quasi-species structure of which we don't know much at present about its relevance for epidemiology or for the evolution of the virus. There is systematic selection of quasi-species and viral sequences during the acute infection phase, but we don't see much immune escape in the experiment. There are high rates of Woody-Norse recombination in capsid genes that are not observed on a larger scale for a series of reasons that we can hypothesize, at least. We know that the replication in the carrier state is present, but is much slower than during the acute infection, about 40 times lower. And we know that there are lots of epistatic interactions in fitness within hosts. And we speculate that there could be similar interactions during the transmission and the infection process. And this has some complex large-scale consequences in terms of the generation of diversity of the virus and speciation as well, but I don't have time to discuss that point. Thank you very much. These are the collaborators, especially Antonello, Eva, Brian, and Paolo, who were the ones that were driving this project. And ready to take questions. Thank you very much.